All right, now, Sarah Palin, you would have to say, is probably, without a doubt, the most famous Alaskan on the planet. All right, it was probably Ted Stevens or Scotty Gomez, and then she just completely crushed.
Yes.
And I believe...
she's in a stratosphere of
oh, absolutely.
Around.
Who's this on the phone?
Hello, guys. How are you? It's Sarah.
Hi, Sarah Palin.
How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm doing just great. I've been missing you.
Oh, that's...
You know...
It's funny that you would say that, because I was thinking last night, couldn't sleep, I'm thinking, what the hell am I going to ask Sarah Palin? You know, they haven't already asked her already. And the only thing that I could think of is... you know, from where you were just a few years ago to where you are now, and I challenged our listeners to name one person whose life has changed more in the last 3 years than Sarah Palin, no one could think of anybody. What do you miss the most about the Sarah Palin 3 years ago, where you were, you know, mayor of Wasilla, you hadn't become governor yet, you were still our small town girl, you know, you could go to the state fair and you had one guy kind of hanging out with you? I mean, what is it about your life that used to be to where your life is now that you miss the most?
I think I miss being able to say what I want to say without fear of anything being misconstrued or broadcast over the airwaves all over the world in some context that it wasn't meant to be. Just the candidness, you know, that you get to so enjoy, and that freedom of speech essentially that you enjoy. I miss a little bit about that because Bob and Mark, it seems that whatever I say, including on this show today, and whatever you say, may come back to bite me in the butt.
Sure.
But I don't really. I mean, I'm still going to do what I'm going to do and be who I am and say what I want to say, but I miss a little bit of that freedom.
Sure. We, you know, it's true. I mean, but, you know, you remember the things that your parents tell you, and I remember they say, you know, one of the, and it's a constant throughout our lives so far, don't sweat the things you can't control.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah, that's good.
It just brings you unnecessary grief, right?
Yeah, that's true. And Todd and I try to remind each other that really on a daily basis, and remind our kids that too. And then we just move forward every day, and we're taking it day by day.
How difficult is it for Todd, and I know it's difficult for you to speak for him, but as your husband, one of the things when you marry someone is you become their protector.
Oh,
how
yes.
difficult has it been for him to maintain his composure when some of the awful, ugly, horrible things about you have been said, for him to you know, keep the gloves off, so to speak?
I'm sure it's as difficult for him when it comes to his role in our family having to deal with me as it is for me to bite my tongue and keep the gloves on or off when it comes to my kids, when our kids are attacked too. You know, I feel the same way Todd probably feels. You want to protect, you want to go clobber somebody, but you have to restrain yourself and keep on remembering what is really important. Stay focused.
We're talking with Sarah Palin. What is the most surreal moment you've had recently, where you just like, wow, is this really happening?
A whoa moment.
Yesterday, I was out on a Fognack Island in a logging camp, and we felled a couple of huge trees because we're documenting how Americans build industry and how we build our businesses with resources, and we get to document that here in Alaska. So we're out there felling these trees, huge trees, and one falls and it shakes the ground as it crashes and hits the moss, and the lumberjack turns to me and says, "Would you sign the butt of this tree for me?"
Is that the first butt you've been asked to sign?
It's the first butt I signed, and there it was with a Sharpie out in the middle of nowhere, out in the woods, and I autographed the butt of his tree.
Man.
We have lots of surreal moments. Every day something comes up that just you know, makes us laugh, makes us chuckle. Makes us remember that, you know, we're in a blessed position right now to be able to do some good things for Alaska and promote Alaska. If some Alaskans would just give us a chance to get out there and do some positive things without criticizing every step we take.
What has hurt the most?
Definitely it's the attacks on the kids. What has hurt the most has been the misreporting the lies about the kids, and those still are nonstop. And you know why it is? Because I've been a bit too naive and candid about what I feel when it comes to attacks on my kids. I suppose if I would have had my guard up from day one and said, ah, go ahead, say what you want about my kids, and I'm not going to react. But no, instead I'm like, ooh, they know what buttons to push, and they say something about the kids, and it's hurtful, and I've been pretty honest about that. So, you know, that just provides them more reason to go after the kids, I guess.
Yeah, and I think, you know, but the thing is, I believe most people in this country would say, you know what, good for you. We can empathize with you. We understand where you're coming from. We all got families, and nobody would begrudge you feeling that way about your kids. You're supposed to.
Well, I would hope so. Yeah, I know that you guys understand, and you know, you guys are, you live for your kids too, and you only want the best for them, and you can't live their life for them. And both you guys, because you have young kids, just wait until they become teenagers and young adults, and they start making their independent decisions, and you have to let go and hope that the decisions that they make are in the long run good for them. You guys are going to find that out. And
Sarah, you have to understand, I have a 15-year-old boy who, by the way, thinks Willow is a babe. So,
and I have a 13-year-old girl who thinks you are, you know, you are the hero to her. The perfect example of a successful woman.
Well, that's encouraging. To imagine, though, having their decisions played out on a national stage is kind of an uncomfortable thing. But at the end of the day, still, it's all good, because we do have an opportunity to fulfill something that Todd and I have wanted to do ever since I can remember. That's do good things for Alaska, promote this state. Let the rest of America know of the uniqueness and the vastness and the richness of the people and the resources that we have here in America, and why it is that here in Alaska we can start contributing more to the rest of the U.S. to help secure this nation. We have an opportunity to do that, and, you know, we'll take the shots. We'll take the heat that comes with this opportunity, because we know that in the end, what we're going to be able to accomplish in promoting Alaska is going to far outweigh, that good will far outweigh the bad.
Yeah. You know,
Sarah, you know, looking back, you know, we all have moments of, you know, self-reflection. Have you had moments where you've thought, maybe I made a mistake? Do you ever look back on what's going on in the state of Alaska and say, you know what, I would do things a little bit differently if I were governor? Do you have those moments?
I really wish that we would have had more tools at our disposal to come back and fight against those who besmirched the record of our administration. Because when we still read reports today that our administration had ethical challenges or did something that ultimately would harm the residents whom we were serving, and we had to just kind of sit back, especially once I came back from the vice presidential trail, and it seemed like everything that I would do resulted in one of the political adversaries with a complicit media in their back pocket filing an ethics charge or a lawsuit or something to stymie us and paralyze us. We were literally paralyzed, and we didn't have the tools at our disposal to get out there and fight those charges in the court of public opinion. I wish that we could have been more aggressive in setting the record straight, because it wasn't fair to Alaskans for them to have to sit back and wonder, really? Is, for instance, is she wearing an Arctic cat coat that she's been wearing for the last 15 years to promote her husband's racing team, or is this just a natural thing for an Alaskan to be out there in their snow machine garb? Well, an example like that, I think, is kind of the epitome of the stupidity that we went through, and then we didn't have the opportunity to set the record straight and fight for what was right, because we were so overwhelmed. We were drowning in that paralysis, those things that they were hitting us with.
Saying that your administration had ethical challenges, I would say that's like saying a kid who gets beat up every day at school has violence issues.
Yeah.
Well, you know, thank God if people paid attention, we've proven that there were not the ethical challenges, one after another, of the lawsuits that we won and the ethics violation charges that were frivolous and costly and wasteful. We won. And you didn't see that in the media. You didn't see those proclamations of victories on our administration side, but we won. And I know I can sleep well at night knowing that we did good things for the state. And I'm here in Kodiak out on the docks, and we have some nice fishermen hollering hello to us.
I heard some sirens in the background. Does Andrew McLeod know where you're at?
I know, I wonder. We got a crazy, crazy blogger over here, too, that he lives over here, and I think he's a stringer for CNN now, following us around quite often.
Is it fair?
I just wait for him to pop up.
Yes.
Is it fair, Sarah, to say that if these ethical charges, these that kept coming and coming and coming and handcuffing you from doing the job that you wanted to do, is it a fair, I guess, to say that if those ethical charges